Please stand. In the name of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the word of the Lord to which I direct your attention for encouragement and our strengthening in faith this morning is that which is recorded in Jeremiah chapter 33, verses 14 through 16. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will fulfill the good promise I made to the people of Israel and Judah. In those days and at that time, I will make a righteous branch sprout from David's line. He will do what is just and right in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved and Jerusalem will live in safety. This is the name by which it will be called: the Lord, our righteous Savior. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. In the name of Jesus Christ, the fulfillment of all God's promises, dear heirs of his righteousness. So a young couple is leaving their home on a Friday evening. It's 5:30 p.m. And they're entrusting their home, as well as their two children, a four-year-old and a six-year-old, into the hands of a sitter. And so they give instructions to the sitter, and they head out for a nice night out by themselves. And when they return at 11 p.m., they walk into the house, and they see this: 15 teenagers dancing to ear-shattering music in the living room. And in the bathroom, in the tub, on ice is a keg of beer. And on the couch are the 4- and 6-year-old sipping some from glasses. Would you have that sitter back again? A night watchman is on duty for a large department store. And in the room where he is seated, there is a bank of monitors that are connected to a variety of cameras located throughout the facility. But the screen upon which this night watchman is focusing doesn't have cameras or feed from cameras from around the store, but it has a feed to his portable video game that he is playing. If you were the store owner, would you feel that your business is secure? Now, you and I could come up with a word that would aptly describe the sitter and a night watchman like this, right? And I think that word would be irresponsible. They were given a trust. They were given a responsibility. Things to care for and to watch out for, and they totally neglected them because they didn't care about anyone else's interests but their own. Following the days of Israel's last judge, the prophet Samuel, the people of Israel requested from God and received a king. Kings to lead them. And Old Testament kings, kings who were given the responsibility of taking care of the nation of Israel, had more than just the responsibility of making sure that civil justice was maintained and carried out, more than just the responsibility of protecting them from aggressive neighbors outside their borders. They were to be the guardians of the faith. They were to be the protectors of the visible church of God on earth. That was their responsibility. Now, initially, Israel had a mix of responsible and irresponsible kings. But when it came to the last 100 years of their history, they had a string of irresponsible kings. kings who didn't protect the citizens. They took advantage of them, they stole from them, they oppressed them. But even worse than that, kings who neglected their role as being the guardians of the faith in Israel. For the last two kings, they had introduced temples to false gods throughout the city and even put up idols to false gods within the temple of the Lord. And what was worse, they persecuted the faithful prophets, the faithful servants of the Lord, like Jeremiah. And so what happened is, by their bad example and their bad leadership, the people of Israel fell away from true faith in the Lord and love for the Lord. They began to drink the wine of unbelief and immorality. As a result, God's people fell away from him. They were utterly irresponsible. And so if you were God, would you keep them as the guardians of your people? Well, no more than you would have that babysitter back who threw a party while supposedly watching your kids, right? No more than you would want to have that night watchman continue in your service when all he's doing is playing video games and not paying attention to the store. And so the Lord our God didn't want those types of kings to continue leading and guiding his people any more than you would want that babysitter and night watchman caring for your people and your things. Something had to change. And that's why the Lord said through the prophet Jeremiah, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will fulfill the good promise I made to the people of Israel and Judah. In those days and at that time, I will make a righteous branch sprout from David's line. He will do what is just and right in the land." At Christmas, we celebrate God making good on his good promise. We celebrate the birth of Christ. And it's the Apostle Paul who draws the connection between Jesus and this good promise from God when he says, "Paul, a servant of Christ, set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his Son, who as to his human nature was a descendant of David." So he very clearly is saying that righteous branch that was promised through Jeremiah from the line of David, that is Christ himself. And he's going to be completely different from the other descendants of David who ruled over God's people. They were irresponsible over and over again. Because this one would be a special son of David, one who was not only David's son, but the son of God himself. A ruler who would not be irresponsible, but would be completely responsible. And notice what he's called, the Lord our righteous Savior. Our righteous Savior. Now that word righteousness, or righteous, is a word that isn't used too much anymore. Occasionally, you will hear people use the word righteous. Oh, that's a righteous pair of sunglasses you're wearing. Well, what do they mean by that? Well, that's snazzy. That's outstanding, right? That's not exactly how it's meant here. Righteous means right. Unlike the kings, the other kings from the line of David, everything Jesus came to do and did was right. Right in the eyes and in the sight of God. And that's why we need him so much. Because like the other kings of the line of David, you and I haven't been such good examples in our lives either. Right? Have you ever had too much to drink? drink alcohol to the point of drunkenness? And others have seen you do it, maybe even your own children? Have there been those moments where your self-control was less than stellar? When because your ego was injured, you lashed out at the people around you? Or when you were spreading muck and gossip about your family members and your co-workers and your neighbors? Or by what you watch on television, the music you listen to, or the websites you visit? Or perhaps told those jokes, or listened to jokes and laughed, jokes of which the Lord, our Father in heaven, would cringe when he hears because they're ungodly, they're laughing at sin? Oh, we need a righteous Savior. We need his righteousness. Because without that, you and I, remember as I read in our gospel lesson, our first lesson, we would have every reason to be terrified and to tremble when Jesus comes again to end this present age. Because we would be found wanting in the sight of our God. No matter how hard we try, we can't undo the sins of our past. If I were perfect for today, that would only count for today. I can't make up for yesterday, and neither can you. But Jesus, in his life, always spoke the truth, always served as a good example, always was responsible, protected those whom God entrusted to his care. And he never oppressed anyone. He was the perfect man, the perfect human being. And that righteousness of Jesus, that rightness of his, is his gift to you. So you can wrap yourself up in it. And through faith, you are in that shielded blanket. So when God comes again and his judgment rains down on everyone on the earth, you will be spared. You'll be gathered up to be with Jesus in the air. And he will rule over you in a perfect world forever. So you don't need to be afraid when Jesus comes again. But what about now? We have to get through today and then tomorrow. And however long it takes before we either leave this life or Jesus comes again. Well, we have these words from the prophet Jeremiah. In those days, Judah, God's people, will be saved and Jerusalem will live in safety. That's not just referring to when Jesus comes again. That's referring to now. Our Lord Jesus lived and he died and he rose again so that you could have his righteousness and you're clothed in it right now. And he's ascended to the right hand of the Father, and from there he rules over everything in the now. That doesn't mean you won't have struggles. No, Jesus guaranteed you will have struggles. In this world you will have trouble, he said. But he said, take heart because I have overcome the world. And so the Christian life is one of struggle. Struggle against your own evil desires from your sinful flesh. Struggle against everything that Satan is trying to throw at us from the outside to mislead us, to deceive us. And there's all the painful things we have to endure from others, sometimes because we believe in Jesus, sometimes just because that's what happens. We get caught up in the midst of things in this world. But remember, Jesus is not an irresponsible king. He's a responsible king. He's not distracted watching video games. He's not whooping it up in heaven and forgetting about you. No, he has seen to it that his word remains, right? Even today we have the word of Christ to guard our faith from the lies of the world and to guide us as we live our lives to his glory. Even now, from the right hand of the Father, Jesus has set limits to what this world can do to us. We may feel oppressed and overwhelmed, But yet we are not overcome because Jesus is our shield. And the evil that you endure, the hardships that you are experiencing, they're not going to be forever, but rather Jesus will strengthen you and provide a way out for you when the time is right so that you can get through it until the day he comes again. And on that day, we will live in ultimate safety, right? Free from all the struggle that we presently experience. I think some of you can remember times when perhaps your parents went away for several days at a time. Maybe it was a five-day getaway. They went away to a wedding, and only they were invited, and you couldn't go along. Okay, and so you were left in the care of an aunt or maybe a sitter, and that was okay, right? They took care of you. They made sure you had food on the table, but auntie didn't cook like mom, right? Auntie didn't read bedtime stories like dad or romp like dad with you. Huh? They didn't know you like your parents. So at the end of those 5 days, what was it like for you when mom and dad came home? When they walked in that door, you came running, right? Mom and dad are here. Now everything's going to be back the way it was supposed to be or supposed to be, right? Brothers and sisters, that's the way it's going to be for you and for me when Jesus comes again. Yes, he is guarding and keeping us from above through this present age of struggle. But when he comes again, he's going to create a new heavens and a new earth, and everything will be made the way it was supposed to be from the very beginning. And we will dwell in peace and in safety, and we will rest from all our struggles forever. And so during this Advent season, and as we look to Jesus coming again, do so with great joy, confident that Jesus, your King, is a responsible ruler who keeps his word and keeps his promises. Amen. Please stand. And now I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. Please join me now in singing the Te Deum. We praise you, O God.